is my journey through Elmina and Cape Coast castles in Ghana, formerly known as Gold Coast, due to its abundance of gold. Between 1525 and 1860, approximately 12.5 million enslaved Africans were transported from Western and Central Africa to the Americas, Europe, and West Indies. About 10 to 15% perished on the sea during the Middle Passage and never got to their final destination. Portuguese were the first to engage in the transatlantic slave trade, completing their first slave trade voyage to Brazil in 1526. Portuguese arrived Gold Coast in 1471, led by their captain Don Diego for gold trade, and this subsequently gave rise to Elmina and hence Africans in diaspora. From 1500s, with the inception of obnoxious transatlantic slave trade, the gold trade shifted to human trade. Elmina Castle is one of the oldest European buildings outside Europe, and the historic town of Elmina is believed to be the location of first contact point between Europeans and sub-Saharan Africans. Elmina Castle, also known as St. George's Castle, was built in 1471 by the Portuguese. This castle exchanged hands multiple times, from the Portuguese to Dutch and finally to British. In 1637, the locals were fed up with the Portuguese and assisted the Danes to take over the castle. But unfortunately, the Dutch were not the angels they were looking for. Rather, they came in, took in more slaves, extended the building and set up a marketing place where the slaves could be auctioned. The life of a captive never got any better. Every stage was more sensitive than the previous, full of misery and despair. A whole family could be captured but only separated on the arrival to the castle. Most people never saw each other again. Some couple could see each other but never got to talk, rather kept sobbing out of despair and suffering. The official age for slavery was 13 years. However, children below this age were captured and sold. Children above the age 10 were sold individually, otherwise sold together with an adult. The ones older than 50 years of age had their hair shaved off and smeared with oil for them to look much younger before being sold into slavery. In the castle, strong men and women were known as commercial captives, while the weak ones were called domestic captives. Pregnant women were not allowed to stay inside the dungeons. When identified, were flung into the ocean. Due to sexual abuse, some women became pregnant inside the dungeon and delivered in chains or taken to town to deliver. After delivery, the woman either remained in the town with her baby, which meant freedom from slavery, or went back immediately to the dungeon. Cape Coast Castle is one of the famous castles in Ghana's dark history. It began as a lodge constructed by the Portuguese in 1555, later taken over by the Swedes in 1653, and built into a fort in 1654. It played a significant role in the transatlantic slave trade. About 25% of African slaves transported into slavery came to Cape Coast Castle. Due to stiff European competition, the fort was occupied by different slave traders at different times. In 1958, by the Dutch when seized power from the Swedish, and by British when they conquered in 1664. By 1700, the British has transformed it into this very castle we are seeing today. This transformation took 60 years to be completed using the locals. In the castle, there were male and female slave dungeons. Children and adults stayed together. Just imagine a child below 10 years of age inhaling the stench of adult excretion. The dungeons were a dark room with only three holes to let in light. There were also a spy hole through which the soldiers monitored the captive. Generally, the chained captive stayed 3 months in poorly ventilated dungeons with no place to lie down and very little light, full of misery, agony, suffering, abuse, intimidation and torture as the case may be. Without water or sanitation, the floor of the dungeon was littered with human feces, urine, vomit, and menstrual blood. They were locked under this dreadful condition, and many captives fell seriously ill. Little food were thrown at them, and those who could not scramble for food were killed by hunger. Some decided to commit suicide by embarking on voluntary hunger strike. Those who died in dungeon exceeded those who survived, and their bodies were thrown into the ocean for sharks to feed on. Identification of slaves by several slave traders was done by stamping a red-hot branded iron on men's chests and hands, and women on their backs. On the arrival of slave ships at the end of 3 months, the survived captives, including women and children, with chains around their necks and in shackles, sometimes chained in groups of 5, 10, or 15, were forced to walk 70 meters long underground tunnel through the door of no return to the boat and then on board the big slaving ship. In the ships, they were made to crouch and cramp in the space where cargoes are usually kept, and the sick people were thrown overboard into the ocean to protect the rest of the crew from getting infected. But surprisingly, these slave ships came with wonderful names such as God is Able, Jesus, Liberty, Lord, Santa Maria, and a host of other beautiful names. The door of no return is the portal through which the slaves exit and never to set foot again in their homeland, and a final goodbye to the freedom they once knew and experienced. This is where they lost contact with their ancestors, and most of them found dignity in committing suicide voluntarily instead of being transported to the New World, the Americas, and the Caribbean. On the flip side, there is an extravagant apartment devoid of the stench and misery of the dungeons for the white governors. This included a living room with 9 windows and well ventilated bedroom with 5 windows, with beautiful parquet floors and scenic view of the blue water of the Atlantic Ocean. There was a balcony with a courtyard from where he selects any woman of his choice. He would order the soldiers to watch the woman in the center of the courtyard, with other captives looking on. After the humiliation, she would get dressed and given little food. Then she would pass through the trap door to the governor's bedroom. Finally, the soldiers who escorted her back sometimes also raped her. On the contrary, the woman who refused the advances from the governor was fitted with 8 iron balls of cannon around her ankles and made her to stand under the sun in the rain without food until pardon was granted. The condemned cell was a pitchy dark room with no opening. This was for the captives who revolted, fought for their freedom, made an attempt to escape, and sometimes women who said no to sexual abuse or resisted rape from the officers. They were left with no food, no light, and no water till their death. Right on top of dungeons was a church on the dungeon. At Cape Coast Castle, the church was Society for the Propagation of the Gospel, SPG, which was an Anglican church pastored by a Ghanaian reverend known as Philip Kweku, whose father was a slave trader, and at Elmina Castle was St. George's Catholic Church. As a sign of apology, the National House of Chiefs in Ghana came together and proclaimed that never will this kind of inhuman act happen again by unveiling a foundation stone at Cape Coast Castle. Even in the 21st century, the castles continue to pay respect to the millions of people who languish in the hands of slavers. African traditional chiefs also contributed to the slave trade by selling the criminals together with their prisoners of war to European buyers in exchange for guns and ammunition. By innocent ones captured, but most of other slaves were obtained from kidnapping or through raids together with the Europeans at gunpoint. Slavery has ended, but modern slavery is still on, such as human trafficking and child labor. Let's unite against modern slavery. With this, I say thank you for watching and see you in my next video.